When you think of heist movies, your mind probably immediately goes to crazy safes, elaborate plans, and larger-than-life characters that have been robbed by society. And then you have Hayao Miyazaki's Lupin the Third, The Castle of Cagliostro. Cagliostro is one of the most stylish and whimsical movies I've ever seen, bouncing around between cartoonish, entertaining set pieces and quieter atmospheric moments with such ease that it's no wonder why Miyazaki has become the legend he has. Like so many of his later works, the visual storytelling and comedy really shine here, offering so much about everyone and everything in this world. You could practically put this movie on mute and absorb all the information you need to know, from the villain's introduction occurring as he's undressed while walking by his butler that looks like Danny DeVito from Batman Returns, to the way that Lupin and Jigen play rock, paper, scissors to decide who has to change their car's tire, a small interaction that instantly sells and relates their dynamic to the viewer. And when the film decides to kick things up a notch, the action is some of the cleanest in history, as literally 6 minutes in, this movie kicks off one of the most energetic car chases of all time. It's a movie that so clearly knows it's animated and takes advantage of that whenever and wherever possible. Like, you're seeing it right now. The expressiveness, the exaggerated elements of it all. It's so fluid, and often the animators completely change the color palette, a brilliant technique that modern anime's push for realistic lighting has unfortunately largely lost. You don't have many other animated movies working in this genre. In fact, in 1979, when the movie first came out, the only other one you'd have was Lupin the Third, The Mystery of Mamo from 1978. And like that movie, Cagliostro takes the viewer through a series of one-of-a-kind exploits that always leave you in suspense about what's going to happen next. These bits of dense action are so well offset, however, by Miyazaki's trademark use of ma, intentional energetic low points in the film, where he allows the characters and the viewers to breathe in the scenery and the world and just think.
Beautiful day.
Instead of constantly filling in empty space with quips like less capable and confident Western directors would, he just lets the natural scenery shine through. And the score of the film, done by Yuji Ohno, perfectly encapsulates both of these moods, switching from high-octane jazz that's smoother than Land O'Lakes butter to more contemplative and introspective pieces, reeling you back into the world cleanly and gently. One of the most interesting and original aspects of that world's design is the film's oddly small-scale locale. So many spy and thief movies have these grandiose metropolitan settings. Vegas, New York, even movies as early as 1965's Thunderball were already making use of urban places like Miami. And yet, 40 years later, few have matched the uniqueness of Cagliostro's giant Cinderella-esque castle, or its small-town cobblestone road setting in the countryside. We're talking about a director that said one day he would love to see Manhattan underwater and wild green grasses taking over, so of course this setting appeals to him perfectly. In any other action movie, a dining scene would take place in a fancy establishment, dimly lit and with dramatic dialogue moodily exchanged. But here, it's a homey little restaurant, where our main characters have a little tussle over who gets more spaghetti in the background of their conversation.
What's wrong?
I want to know what's going on here, pal.
What are you talking about?
You knew that girl. And there's just so much of that uniqueness and flair baked into every frame of this movie. Even the villain, instead of using some fancy helicopter or private jet, just owns an autogyro. You probably don't even know what an autogyro is. For reference, it's this, and it's really cool. It's the kind of vehicle pick you'd expect from someone who truly loves mechanical design and planes, and wants to impart that into the work. The kind of pick only Hayao Miyazaki would make. All in all, the film as a whole feels like something only Miyazaki could have made. It's a really fun romp, and is made with more heart and thought than 95% of modern action movies. I don't often say things like this, but it's the kind of thing that reminds me of why I watch movies in the first place. So many times, I feel like I'm watching something that just doesn't feel real.
Notorious P.I.G.
I'm not saying that I think every movie needs to have complex theming, heck, I wouldn't say Cagliostro does. But there's such an intangible, yet remarkably tangible difference between something that comes from the soul of its creator and something that doesn't. And believe me, this movie does. Allow yourself to experience Lupin III, the Castle of Cagliostro, and you'll be greeted with one of the most electrifying and engaging movies cinema has ever crafted. So don't keep Lupin waiting. That's gonna wrap it up for this video and for this year. I wanted to end it on as triumphant a note as possible, so I figured the last video should probably just be me talking about a movie I really, really like as long as possible. So I landed on this movie, which is brilliant and is currently streaming on Netflix, so please go check it out. At any rate, if you like this video, make sure to leave a like, and if you loved it, consider subscribing. If you do end up checking out the movie afterwards, please let me know down in the comments below. It always makes my day to hear that, like, one of my videos actually made someone go check out the thing I was talking about, because that is basically my biggest goal with talking about movies in the first place. But that's where I'm going to end it. So that's going to be all for this video, guys. Random Recorders, peace out. Have a great new year, and make sure to take care of yourself.